Hey everyone, Mr. Happy here, and in this video, we're going to be taking a look at the updates to the Final Fantasy 16 website. They added new sections for the world and some characters. Not a whole lot, but something to chew on, because they said we wouldn't be getting much more after this until 2021. And, well, we're going to be chewing on this for a while, so I might as well start now. Apologies in advance, by the way. The weather's been changing like crazy here, and my congestion is just so bad because of it. So I'll try not to trip over my words or make any disgusting sounds, but it's one of the reasons I haven't been recording much in the past few days. Anyway, with that, let's just scroll down and get started because there is a lot to say. So as you can see, we have the world and we have the characters. Now, in my opinion, the world is the more interesting thing, but we're going to actually start with the characters, because there's not as much text here. There's a little bit to pull apart, and it'll help me with referencing certain characters and certain things later in the actual world section. So our main protagonist, the character that people have been lovingly calling Shardbert, is Clive Rossfield, the firstborn son of the Archduke of Rosaria. Though all expected him to inherit the Phoenix's flame and awaken as the dominant, destiny instead chose his younger brother Joshua to bear this burden. In search of a role of his own, Clive dedicated himself to mastering the blade. His practice pays off when at just 15 years of age, he wins the ducal tournament and is dubbed the first shield of Rosaria, tasked to guard the Phoenix and blessed with the ability to wield a part of his fire. Alas, Clive's promising career is to end in tragedy at the hands of the mysterious dark icon Ifrit, setting him on a dangerous road to revenge. There's actually a lot to pull apart there. For one, in the trailer, we see that Clive is able to use not only parts of Phoenix's power, but we see bits and pieces where in his older age, he is able to access Titan as well as what we believe is Garuda's power as well. It's worth assuming that he'll be able to also take Shiva's power and any other dominant, which we will definitely be getting into some speculation when we go back to the world page as we go throughout the game. Those are likely to be different weapons, different styles, something along those lines for Clive to use in battle. We know the Phoenix in particular allows him to shoot fireballs as well as use a launcher attack, and that's about all we have on the Phoenix thus far. That being said, they also make mention of Ifrit being the dark icon, which is interesting because in the trailer they refer to him as a second icon of fire. That raises the question, is there a dark icon for all of the various elements, and how are the elements represented precisely in this world? Are the mother crystals more just dedicated to old school Final Fantasy summons? Or are they based in just entirely on different elements? And given what some of the flags look like and things we've seen in the trailer, there's a bit of a question mark. What would be the dark icon for Shiva, for example? There are some candidates out there in the Final Fantasy verse, or they could just do a dark Shiva of some kind. Titan, all the same. There's options across the board, but dark icons is definitely a big thing when we get to talking about what I think is the main actual antagonist of this game. Now moving on to his brother Joshua, the second son of the Archduke of Rosaria, and Clive's younger brother by 5 years. So he's 10 years old when we see him, as we see him right now with the little dog in his hand. Joshua awoke as the dominant of the Phoenix soon after his birth. Despite his noble upbringing, Joshua treats all his father's subjects with warmth and affection, none more so than Clive, whom he deeply admires. Joshua often laments that it was he, the frail and bookish younger son, who was granted command of the Firebird's flames and not his stronger, braver brother. While Clive will gladly throw himself into any danger, Joshua quails at the sight of a carrot on his dinner plate. But carrots become the least of his concern when he too is swept up in the tragic events that change Clive's life forever. Now, in the trailer, we see what is perceived to be the death of Joshua. At the very least, the Phoenix itself appears to be ripped apart. Whether or not that actually means the death of the dominant, or if the dominant actually dies in that encounter at all, is up for debate, but it would make sense given the fact that, as it's stated with Clive here, a dangerous road to revenge. Now, whether that's just the revenge of his nation or the death of his younger brother, either or would make perfect sense. So, I think it's likely Joshua dies, or at least dies in a very Final Fantasy way where he's still relevant throughout the rest of the plot. We still see tons of scene with him and voices and all that good stuff. But again, still just kind of hung on that dark icon thing. Now this is interesting. Jill Warwick. Born in the fallen Northern Territories, Jill was taken from her homeland at a tender age to become a ward of Rosaria, securing peace between the two warring nations. The Archduke insisted that she be raised alongside his sons, and now at 12 years of age, she is as much a part of the Rossfield household as Clive and Joshua. Ever kind, gracious, and unassuming, Jill has become a trusted confidant to the brothers. This makes no mention of the disaster and how it affects her. We don't see her at all in the disaster in the trailer. it's suspicious in a very tinfoil hatty kind of way that she comes from a fallen territory and is injected as a ward into a nation that is be at war with the opposing nation where her fallen region comes from. It's very strange to see how much they put into how much she's potentially a Trojan horse just waiting to happen. The question mark for me is Jill a character we actually see twice in the original trailer? Is she equally the 12-year-old and also the older character we see in the war room later when the Blight is mentioned? It's about placing these things in the timeline, determining what a red herring is. But the simple fact that her fate from that eventful day that leads to Clive's entire life changing is not mentioned. Now, obviously, they could just be leaving it out for spoiler sake, but I don't know. I'm suspicious about her because she's mentioned and then just, oh, you know, they tell her everything. I don't know. I'm maybe telling a confidant for maybe being a confidant for a nation that was once at war with that you were once at war with. Maybe not the smartest of things to do. That's all I'm going to put out there. Just again, tinfoil hat, put it on my head. I don't trust Jill. She's immediately on my list of potential characters to be the actual main antagonist for the game because we don't really have a main antagonist yet, but we're getting there. Now that's just it for the character section. Now we have the world section, which is actually the part I think is more interesting now that we've introduced those three characters. So first of all, I have to call out this artwork we actually saw sometime in 2019 when they started recruiting. Basically, the third business division or creative division three. I can't remember the name. It's listed somewhere on the site. They restructured in April of 2019, and there was a mystery project there. And this was the artwork that was provided. And we all suspected it was Final Fantasy 16. We were all right. And there it is. It's good to see it. And we can actually place where that is on the map, thankfully, when we actually scroll down. So the name of the realm is Velisthea, and its description is as follows. The land of Velisthea is studded with mother crystals, glittering mountains of crystal that tower over the realms around them, blessing them with ether. For generations, people have flocked to these beacons to take advantage of their blessing, using the ether to conjure magics that let them live lives of comfort and plenty. Great powers have grown up around each mother crystal, and an uneasy peace has long reigned between them. Yet now the peace falters as the spread of the Blight threatens to destroy their dominions. Now, we'll be covering a lot about the Blight in this video, but it sounds like the Blight is something akin to the Star Scourge that was that was present in Final Fantasy XV, where it's some sort of unexplained, unknown virus that just is sweeping the land. Now, how it's affecting the inhabitants of Velisthea, I'd assume maybe is not quite equal to the way that the Star Scourge worked in Final Fantasy XV, where it's transforming them into demons, but at the very least, it could make life harder. It could just be killing individuals from being a sickness. It could be destroying crops or fertile land to make it so that nations have to go to war against each other. But it feels injected, considering that the land is considered in an uneasy peace. Something that could topple that could be very, very easy to inject, especially if you're, you know, an evil magical force that's trying to take over the world or destroy it, like most Final Fantasy games are. So I think the Blight is not a natural occurrence, but is deliberately being placed in the story to force these nations to go to war to achieve some sort of end. What that end is, we don't know entirely yet, but we'll get the tinfoil hat back out once we move on to some of the later sections. Now, icons and their dominance, there's not much new here. The icons are the most powerful and deadly creatures in Velisthea. Each resides within a dominant, a single man or woman who is blessed with the ability to call upon their dread power. In some nations, these dominants are treated as royalty in admiration of this strength. In others, they are bound in fear of it and forced to serve as weapons of war. Those who are born as dominants cannot escape their fate, however cruel it may be. This just reconfirms what we assumed from the trailer, what most people guessed, and that dominants can essentially summon the power of these icons and use them for various means, whether it be war or healing or whatever it is. As you can see, depending on the nation, depends on the approach that each of these icons and their dominance actually take inside society. Thankfully, they do go into some detail on the various nations just below this, so this information is really just helping us as we come to understand each of the different nations that reside inside of Velisthea. So anyway, moving on, we go down to the map and the description of six different realms in Velisthea, or at least six different nations. Now, before we go anywhere with this map, I think you can say, I said we were going to point out where the concept artwork is actually available on the map, and it looks to be to the very north. You can see it right here, kind of hanging out right there where my mouse cursor is. And I'm assuming that's going to be a very important location because, well, let's get into talking about the individual nations that are available here. or at least descriptions of them are available. The first one we have is the Grand Duchy of Rosaria. Long ago, a group of small independent provinces in Western Valisthea found strength in unity and formed the Grand Duchy of Rosaria. After years of relative prosperity, the duchy now finds itself threatened by the spread of the Blight, a threat that, left unchecked, would doubtless usher the realm to ruin. Rosaria draws its ether from Drake's Breath, a mother crystal situated on a volcanic island off the coast. The dominant of the Phoenix, icon of fire, is enthroned as Archduke when they come of age. So as we've already established, Joshua is indeed the actual dominant of the Phoenix. Some people maybe thought he was secretly Ifrit, but the trailer tried its best to make us believe that it was Joshua, and that would appear to be the case. If you're looking for the location of this, it's over here on the left. You can see the volcano that is just off the coast. There's a little island under it. And then you can actually see what would be, at the very least, the capital of Rosaria. And that's just a small, small section. Compared to a lot of the other nations that are present here, it appears to be much smaller, have much less ground. It does say that the duchy itself was a lot of small independent provinces, which we can probably see these ones right here, one here, one here. And we can get some other ideas of some other landmarks that we might be visiting or venture across or whatever word I suppose it is you really want to take a look at it. It even looks like there's a port a little bit to the south of Rosaria, which either belongs to Rosaria or maybe to its warring nation to the south. But Rosaria itself, there isn't a whole lot to pull apart. It's really the rest of them that we need to start guessing, because we know about Clive, we know about Josh, we know about Jill. And so we need to really break down what is going on with all the other nations, because they're going to tell us what icons they have, what their motivations are, and maybe give us a little bit more insight into this Blight, because the way it's described here, Blight is only mentioned in Rosaria. So at the very least, it's the location the Blight is starting to spread. And being how young Clive is when the battle between Phoenix and Ifrit actually takes place, it may be just the starting point of the Blight, the first thing in its path, which would also make sense with the dangerous being that becomes Ifrit itself. Moving on to the second nation, I'd also like to point out the flags, by the way. We'll talk about the flags individually, but you can see that Rosaria has a phoenix on their flag, which gives us enough of a hint to start to make predictions about the other nations and what little details are left out with them. So the Holy Empire of Sembrek. Sembrek is the largest theocratic force in Valisthea. The empire's holy capital of Oriflame is built around Drake's Head, the mother crystal that blesses the surrounding provinces with abundant ether. The people happily take advantage of this, living in comfort and security under the watchful gaze of the Holy Emperor, whom they worship as the living incarnation of the one true deity. The dominant of blank serves as the Empire's champion, taking to the field in times of war to rout its enemies. Now, that already sounds like the main villain, right? But we should know with the team that's working on this that the main villain being an empire, they're certainly a villain. We even see them in the trailer invading the lands of Rosaria. But the main villain, I'm going to take a step back from that because I don't think that is actually the case. Now, first I'd like to establish we had Drake's Breath for Rosaria. We have Drake's Head for Sembrek, and all the other nations are going to have some form of Drake in their name. There's a couple of names that come to mind when we see that, and when we get to one of the later nations that gives us the final piece of the Drake Mother Crystal, I think it starts to be a little more apparent who it's actually referring to. Now, who is the dominant of Sembrek? Look at their flag. Their flag has a saint and a couple of dragons on it, actually. So that leaves a few different options. Now, Shiva is a possibility. I will say that this is a nation that is more to the north. It's probably colder up in this direction, although the mountains actually to the northwest, if you look on the map, would be a spot you'd more imagine that to come from. I'm not entirely set on it being a Saint Shiva style thing, something almost modeled after Ishgard in a sense, but the fact that there is the double dragons and a saint has to give us some sort of idea. There are a couple of other candidates, but we'd assume that they're perhaps pulling from, I guess, what I like to call the OG six. You know, there's Ifrit, Garuda, Titan, Ramu, Leviathan. Who am I forgetting? I say Ifrit, Garuda, Titan, Leviathan, Shiva. That was the one I was forgetting. And Ramu. Okay, yeah. So I'd assume they'd be pulling from maybe one of the original six when it comes to this. But we already saw Ifrit was a dark icon. Perhaps the original six are the dark icons in a sense. You know, maybe Ifrit, Garuda, et cetera, et cetera. Maybe they're not a part of these nations. We have the Phoenix, and maybe we have something else. Maybe an Asura or some other named dominant right here. But we have to use the flags, and the flag just, it screams to me Ishgard, which screams to me Shiva and Saint Shiva. So that's where my prediction is now, but a beast of war? I don't know. The only thing that kind of makes sense to me there is the fact that it's a holy emperor. So I would, if there were some knights and like there, technically you can maybe look at this as a giant table. If you actually look, it looks like there are actually seats along this. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and you could argue 12 and 13 are here, are these little nubs right here. Maybe that has some relevance. We don't know if the actual markings on the flags have any significance to the number of people in power or positions of power, because the Knights of the Round are obviously a big thing, or a king that can become like a King Arthur or a Thorin or something. But I have a feeling they'll be pulling from one of those, either Shiva or a Knights of the Round style thing that's going on here. Now that one, a little bit harder to guess. The next one, not so much. By the way, if you're looking for the location of the Holy Empire, it is right here with this, again, where the concept art actually is on the map. Now, moving over to the Kingdom of Waloed. Now, while it says Sandbrick is the largest theocratic force, the Kingdom of Waloed seems to be the actual biggest kingdom. Waloed claims the entirety of Ash, the eastern half of Valisthea. That is all of this continent, essentially, on the right. And we can see that their nation is up here at the top of that actual land. Now, how much of that land is inhabitable is a different story. We don't know. We don't have any information about that, if it's a largely inhabitable land, or inhospitable land. Can't speak today. So it claims the entirety of Ash. The kingdom's control of the continent has oft been tested by the orcs and other beastmen who make their home there, but the current ruler of the realm, dominant of blank, has succeeded in quelling their rebellions. Using the power of the kingdom's mother crystal, Drake's spine, this new king has built up a mighty army with which he now seeks to test the borders of his neighbors. So we have a nation that has grown, has taken over basically almost half of the entirety of the Twin Realms, and is now looking to expand further, if anything, just to test their might. Now, I don't think I need to tell you who their dominant is, because it may be blotted out, but it is the most obvious of them. A horse with six legs, a shield, and what could be interpreted as a sword or a spear. If it's a sword, the handle is in the weirdest spot imaginable. So I'm going to go with more of a spear, maybe a Gungnir of some kind. Is probably Odin. This is almost certainly Odin. Now, whether or not it's aspected to an element, again, we still haven't really figured out if the mother crystals are each aspected to an element, which if we knew Sandbrecht being Shiva, we'd have a better idea of that, but because we don't, that's still a toss-up and people can feel free to predict it as they will. We don't know if this kind of coloration of the shield with Sleipnir and Gungnir and a shield on it, we don't know. It's also two shields. I just realized it's Sleipnir on a white and black shield, and there's a shield on, it's too many shields. We don't know if Odin is lightning aspected. He could be an actual aspect of lightning from his mother crystal. So almost like an Odin-Ixion mix more so than anything else, but at the very least, that's Odin. That's Sleipnir. There's no doubt about that being Sleipnir. Whether or not that's Gungnir on the shield is up for debate, but it's got to be that. So is there a dark icon equivalent of Odin? Ramu? Maybe. I wouldn't be too surprised if they went that road again. I still think these dark icons are going to end up tying back to what I call the OG6. And it makes sense, given they're six. Maybe they'll only use five, but there's something, I'm getting a little ahead of myself. So we've got the Kingdom of Waloed. Most likely their dominant is the dominant of Odin. And that's what we can take away from that. Now we go over to the Dalmekians, which this is the second time we're being introduced to them. They are actually in the trailer for the original, Awakening trailer. The Dalmekian Republic is made up of five states from which the members of its ruling parliament are drawn. Its mother crystal, Drake's Fang, is half hidden in the heart of a mountain range. The Republic's control over it and its ether, securing the obedience of a large part of southern Valisthea. The dominant of Titan, icon of Earth, is installed as a special advisor to Parliament and has significant say in its decision-making. So again, every single one of these seems to talk about how the dominant is part of their society. The first one, the dominant is an archduke. The second one is their champion at war. The third one is the dominant apparently becomes king, or becomes the current ruler of the world, and is one with a taste for power. For the Dalmekians, they become a special advisor and helps with their decision-making very directly. But this is the realm of Titan. If we look on the map, it is this mountain range down here at the bottom, just below the word realms. And we can assume that their nation is actually the one just to the east. Their actual capital is the city to the east. Now, there's not a whole lot to pull from this, but we now know where Titan is from. So that kind of eliminates the whole, maybe the OG6 are a part of the dark icons. So I had kind of forgotten that detail was in there as I've been spouting that out. But it could be that the other members of the OG6 are and Titan just isn't. Because we do see Shiva in the trailer, and that's one of the only reasons that I want to guess that Sandbreck is Shiva. But then there's other lines. There's all sorts of lines that just lead me to just go all sorts of different ways. Because then we come to the Iron Kingdom and the Crystalline Dominion, and this is where it kind of throws all my thinking out the window. The Iron Kingdom is a small group of islands off the coast of Storm, the western half of Alistia's twin realms. Here, the Crystalline Orthodox, an extreme faith that worships crystals, reigns supreme. The Iron Kingdom controls Drake's Breath, the mother crystal that sits in the heart of one of their islands, long a source of contention with the neighboring Rosaria. Isolated and aloof from the mainland nations, the Ironblood speak their own language. Orthodox doctrine judges dominance to be unholy abominations, and any unlucky enough to be born are executed. So if we're looking at these islands, it's kind of hard to see the islands that actually are a part of this, because it's really blocked by everything here. Like, it's so hard to actually get a good look at the islands and where they actually are. Off the coast of Storm, the western half. So you can see the islands are basically over here to the west, somewhat close to, I guess, they're both close to Titan as well as close to Phoenix, or I guess the Dalmekians and Rosaria. So because they're specifically at contention with Rosaria, you have to assume that they're out here. But it doesn't make mention of where their actual crystal is. Well, it makes mention of it, but it doesn't actually show it in any reasonable way on the map, which is kind of surprising. But it could just be because they kind of just don't like dominance. Dominance are just executed when they're born here, and it's kind of messed up. It's kind of messed up in a lot of ways, considering they actually control a mother crystal, and they're, of course, bound to have people who are born as dominant. So it's just weird. Yeah, long source of contention with the neighboring Rosaria. So the Crystalline Orthodox, we have no idea what their actual summon is because their dominants are executed. The question then becomes, so what is their role? They speak a different language. So do they know the language of the realms, or do they just only know their own language? Because what I would have originally assumed here was that when we see Clive all grown up, that he's actually with the Iron Kingdom, who appears to be actually trying to assassinate dominance of other nations. But then that's not entirely set in stone. We have to assume Clive is no longer strictly working with Rosaria by the time he's of older age and is actually part of an assassination squad of the various dominants. And the fact that they're after Shiva's in particular, does that mean they want the Dalmekians to win? Are they trying to fend off specifically whoever's in charge of Shiva? But then we also have to consider, in the trailer, it's mentioned that the Dalmekians push back the Crusaders in the Battle of the Twin Realms. The Crusaders aren't mentioned anywhere here. They're not mentioned in the Crystal Dominion, they're not mentioned in the Iron Kingdom, and they're not mentioned in the Kingdoms of Wallowood. So who are the Crusaders? Are they just a name of a force? Because Battle of Twin Realms implies that the nations in the West are warring the nation in the East. There's only one nation in the other realm, the Eastern Realm of Ash, and that's what makes up the Twin Realms right here. So this is where it's hard to determine if this event actually is happening, like, if this is the same event that we're seeing, the battle in the trailer, or if it's a completely different event in history that they're referring to with the Dalmekians, and that's information we really need to make an educated guess. Because one would assume that the Crusaders summon Shiva, and that Titan is the Dalmekians' response to that. So this is where all the confusion really starts to set in. Maybe there's mother crystals that also we don't know about that haven't been discovered that aren't belonging to any of these existing nations. But who would the Iron Kingdoms be? It's got two axes, and it's just got what looks to be a giant crystal, a giant stalactite, I think that's correct, just on the screen. There's nothing to pull from that, I feel, and two anchor looking symbols at that. There's just not a whole lot to pull from the Iron Kingdom and their flag. Whereas at least with the Dalmekians, we can kind of see their respect for the various elements, a potential religious feature here. We see fire, earth, water, wind, and I can't make out the last one, but I assume it's one of the other elements. We can see that there's like a mutual respect across all of the Dalmekian Republic. And those represent the five provinces, the five different states that make up its ruling parliament. So a lot of questions. A lot of questions, and I'm running out of voice, so I should probably wrap this up quick. Finally, we come to the Crystalline Dominion. The Crystalline Dominion sits at the heart of Velisthea, built around the tallest of the Mother Crystals, Drake's Tail. If you're looking for that, it is dead center in the map, right there. You can see it. That is a huge Mother Crystal comparatively to the rest of them, and it is the largest, according to this one. Or at least it's the tallest. Many bloody battles were fought for control of this small plot of land, due to its strategic importance, till the warring realms finally agreed to an armistice. As part of the peace treaty, the islands around Drake's Tail became an autonomous dominion led by a council of representatives from the surrounding nations, each realm enjoying equal claim to the Mother Crystal's blessing. No dominant makes their home there. Now again, Drake's Tail, Drake's Breath, Drake's Fang, Drake's Spine, Drake's Head, and Drake's... what's the other one? Drake's... no? Where is it? Drake's Fang? Drake's... Wait. Controls Drake's Breath, the Mother Crystal sits in the heart... wait. Drake's... huh? Wait. Now I'm doubly confused. There's two Drake's Breaths. Draws its ether from Drake's Breath, the Mother Crystal situated on the volcanic island of the coast. The Iron Kingdom controls Drake's Breath, the Mother Crystal that sits in the heart of one of their islands. That must be one of their islands, but that would mean two nations are pulling from the same Mother Crystal. I wonder if that's a mistake. I noticed that when I read this before, but there's two Drake's Breaths. Maybe that's why I had such a hard time finding the Iron Kingdom, because it's not as explicitly noted, because maybe that's one of their islands. That would explain why they just kill their dominance. Yeah, I don't know. That's something that I definitely need to see more of, because I hadn't noticed that the last time I read through this, because they're both called Drake's Breath. Well, regardless, the point I was about to make is there's five pieces of a Drake, and then there's, of course, maybe six, depending on breath, whether or not that's a typo and it's supposed to be something else, and then Drake's Tail. Those are all the pieces of a dragon. So there's two theories with that. The one is that the entire realm is situated on the corpse of Midgard Sormer, and that his body is essentially covered in these ether crystals, and that... he's essentially the granddaddy of the entire realm. I think it's a little simpler than that. I just think that the granddaddy's Bahamut instead. I don't necessarily think that this is resting on a corpse. More so that his ether was dispersed and created these mother crystals ages ago. But more importantly, bringing them all together and actually using the power of Drake's Tail could potentially be a way to bring Bahamut into the story. One of the biggest things, again, with Clive is that we've seen he can be blessed by the various dominants, and that at any point he's been blessed by three in the trailers. Now, Titan is one of them. Though that one's super obvious. And Phoenix is obvious. It's even explained here. The remaining one looks to be Garuda, which would likely be the one that belongs to the Iron Kingdom if they did indeed have a dominant that survived their birthright. That's not set in stone in any place, but it seems like the most likely thing, given that Clive actually borrows from Garuda's power. Or again, there could be Mother Crystals that have no nations associated with them. I mean, look at all this land to the northwest that, you know, I guess is in proximity to the Empire, but do they really have all of that uncovered, all of that known? Is it just maybe super hidden? But more importantly, what if somebody with a blessing from every single Mother Crystal received the blessing from Drake's Tail? Would that essentially give them a blessing of Bahamut? Does Bahamut come in as a major antagonist once all these powers are brought into a single location? Is Clive thrown onto a path of revenge deliberately in order to bring about this end time involving Bahamut? It'd be a very Final Fantasy XIV-esque thing for a team that has a lot of overlap in terms of development, terminology, themes with Final Fantasy XIV. And it's entirely a possibility. I think Bahamut's going to play a major, major role in a lot of this, and it's just about placing where the remaining dominants are, and most importantly, who the actual antagonist is. Final Fantasy is too well known for its antagonists, for there to not be an actual face, for it to be some nameless thing like Necron, like the Blight. The Blight has got to be a tool, and I can't help but just feel like Jill is somewhere in the importance of all that. It's just, she has such a tragic backstory to just be forced into this life that she looks like she loves, but it, I don't know, man. I refuse to believe that at face value with the complete omission of how her life has changed by the days when Josh and Clive are just, their worlds are just turned upside down by the blight, by Ifrit, and by the invading empire who is even sending dragoons into their land. There's just so many things to extrapolate, and I love it. I love that we're able to pull apart these various pieces and come up with so many different conclusions as to how this story may actually take place before we've even had more than a single trailer and a single post about its world and its characters. There are so many characters we still have question marks about, so many nations we still have question marks about, and so much more lore to uncover. Not to mention that right next to Drake's tail, I can't help but notice a maelstrom-looking area which appears at the center of the world. Now, that cannot be something that just exists there for no reason, and I don't think that's the location of any of the nations that we were questioning. It's likely to be some sort of mass of energy, of ether, and at the complete center point, if dark icons end up being such a major thing, is it going to be like Dragon Ball GT where the mother crystals have been used for too long and are spawning and are actually the source of the blight itself? Is there an alternate world and universe on the other side of that? Is that a portal to something similar to like what we see in Final Fantasy IX? I don't know. Man, there's so many possibilities of where it could actually go, and there's just little tidbits hidden throughout this map. Not to mention we can see some of the other tiny nations, fortresses. You can see some major landmarks in the middle of this. Like, look at this. This is just like a giant protruding spine or boat front, like coming out of the middle of the land. We got like looks like a wilting tree here, some various fortresses, towns, all sorts of things all over the place. So lots of speculation to be had, lots of excitement for me. I cannot wait for more information on Final Fantasy 16, but it's likely we won't get that information until 2021. Now with that, I barely made it through this video with my voice intact, so I'm going to wrap this up, get it posted to YouTube, and let you guys get to the discussion in the comment section of the video below. Be sure to like, favorite, subscribe, and share, and stay tuned. When more Final Fantasy 16 stuff is coming around the corner, you know we'll be talking about it. Anyway, I'll see you all in the next one, and until then, take care.